Live from San Juan, Puerto Rico, it's theCUBE. Covering Blockchain Unbound. Brought to you by Blockchain Industries.
Okay, welcome back everyone. We're here for exclusive CUBE coverage in Puerto Rico for Blockchain Unbound. Great conference where entrepreneurs and leaders are all here, coming together at a global level. You got investors, you got entrepreneurs, you got the ecosystem developing. We've got a covering for you. I'm John Furrier, your co-host of theCUBE. Next guest, Joe Moen, CEO of Chimes, industry executive, a lot of experience, doing an ICO, doing some great work. Joe, welcome to theCUBE.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
So, tell us first what Chimes is doing. You got an interesting approach with music.
Okay.
What are you guys doing? Is there an ICO in the future? Have you done an ICO? Give the quick update.
Okay, sure. Well, Chimes is a digital media company, and we are consolidating music-related search results on Google in a similar way to what Amazon did with IMDb, consolidating film and television results many years ago. Amazon built an audience of about 250 million to 500 million monthly users, and we expect we can create an audience on that order of magnitude over time. So, just like IMDb is the third largest entertainment website in the world, it is our objective to create the fourth largest one.
What's the value proposition there? You acquire audience, use that audience to tokenize. How does the token economics fit into all this?
Well, first, like any media company, the first thing you have to is an audience, right? I mean, I remember I interviewed for a job with CBS when I was out of college, and in the interview they said, do you know what we make here? And I said, you make TV shows. They go, no, we make audiences, right? So we have to make an audience with a good product. The audience will be driven primarily by search, okay? But we also do have a double ICO in our future. We monetize a big audience. You can monetize with advertising, but that's not enough to make big money anymore, right? We all know that. So we have a layer of crypto products over and above that that we're going to be launching, including, for example, inter-country commerce, hiring producers in another country, hiring songwriters, et cetera, but automating that so we can do it on scale with smart contracts. So we are creating a microcurrency that we can use on the website, but we're doing an ICO for that, but that's not for the purpose of raising capital.
That's part of the business model.
That's part of the business model.
That's not the financial aspect of it.
Correct, and that's done so we can scale international commerce with automation. We're doing an actual ICO for the equity, for securities tokens as well. Now, I've done a full IPO myself, okay, my first company. I had Microsoft and Novell as my shareholders, and there was a full S-1, full registration.
You went through the whole process.
Yeah, but I'm also doing, I also did a Form 10 once, 10 years ago, for another reason. So what we're doing is we're doing the first, possibly the first, one, certainly one of the first, but I think the first, registration with the SEC of a company actually doing an ICO. And we're doing that using, I don't want to call it a loophole in securities laws, but there is a provision in the 1934 Securities Act called Section 12G. And what this does is it allows us basically to go public by telling the SEC we're doing it without having to delay it to wait for their permission. Okay, a Form 10 looks just like an S-1, but when you file it, it's automatically effective 60 days after you file it, period. And so what we're doing is...
Period, full stop, no issues, no questions.
No issue, right. So what
so
we're doing...
So you have to fill all the same paper, S-1,
correct.
The normal format, do the business plan,
right.
The normal paperwork.
Now, right, now in 1930...
But there's no comments come back? Ship it to them?
Comments come back, and you have to clear them, just like with a prospectus, just like with an S-1. However, that doesn't delay it becoming effective. It's effective 60
so
days later.
So they could be commenting during the 60-day time clock going on, but after 60 days,
it's
you're
effective.
In.
So we'll continue to clear comments, But the thing is, with tokens, who knows how long that'll take? I mean, is the SEC going to shepherd something through with crypto on it, or are they going to make it take 5 years? I don't know. Who knows? So the thing is, we are complying with all of the laws for registration, but 60 days after we file it, it's effective. Now, what we're doing is, in the pre-sale for the tokens, we're not issuing the tokens themselves to the buyers in the pre-sale for 6 months. Okay, and the reason for that is they will have met the statutory holding period. So once the Form 10 is effective, those buyers can sell freely on token exchanges.
And what's the statutory holding period, 6 months?
Generally 6 months. There's a few exceptions for affiliates, like an insider
so,
like me.
So I'm confused. The holding period kicks in before or after 6 months?
After 6 months, the statutory holding period is satisfied.
So you're going to wait to delay them anyway, 6 months.
Yes.
So that covers the holding period.
Correct. And then we file the Form 10. 6 days later, they can trade, and anybody can buy them.
Should you file a Form 10 before the 6-month holding period?
No, it'll be about the same time.
Okay.
The reason being is because we have to get all the ducks in a row to be a public company, right? I mean,
cutting edge advice here. This is fantastic. So you're basically going to be the first ICO that actually files with the SEC.
Correct.
I mean, who does that? Nobody. You.
Well, yeah, watch us.
You know, that's awesome.
Basically, we're using a provision. It's like we went back in time to 1934, got them to put something in the 1934 Securities Act for the purposes of ICOs. And then in 2018, we came back to 2018 with the time machine.
Are you from the future? Back to the future. You went back and jury-rigged the, hey, we should put this Form 10 in there.
There you go.
It could come in handy someday during the crypto bubble.
That's right.
Okay, so let's get back to the cryptography thing, because I think cryptocurrency thing. So I think you're onto something really, I think is a tell sign that I haven't seen yet. I've been seeing some formation of it. You are using two types of tokens.
Correct.
So your business model is do security token for funding.
Right.
Trade that puppy.
Right.
Through the Form 10.
Correct.
Utility token, another separate ICO,
right,
for the product.
Right.
And that's going to have one token, two tokens?
There's one utility token, so to speak, one currency token, and that has its own regulations you have to manage too also. But that's designed to appreciate but not like to go up.
Okay, so I want to dig into that for a second, because you mentioned scale.
Right.
You're going to scale your business model with the utility token. That's the purpose of the utility token.
Correct.
So let's go into how you're going to do these smart contracts. So let's just say that a producer in Europe somewhere in Italy says, hey, I'm going to do something with Joe in the UK.
Yes.
And they form a collaboration.
Yes, well, that's right. And
do they use that utility token or a new token gets created?
No, that utility token. That it's called the Chime token. And what happens with that token is you can build in the contract administration to the token. Right now, you can do international deals. I mean, people do them every day. The difficulty is if you've got an audience of 500 million people a month, for example, okay, to do that on scale and automate it, okay? Right now, if you do a deal with somebody in Japan, the American has to have an American lawyer and a Japanese lawyer.
That's a nightmare.
So to see, and if there's a dispute, good luck suing. I one time had a customer in Hong Kong owed me $1.5 million, and he's like, sue me, okay? And I'm in New York, he's in Hong Kong, and, good luck. With smart contracts.
So what did you do? Did you do the New York thing? I'm flying over, I'm gonna break your legs.
We bitched and complained, threatened them, and ultimately we settled on 30 cents on the dollar. That's what we did. That's exactly what happened. So with a situation like this, with smart contracts, you neither side has to hire two sets of lawyers in the other countries.
So Chime takes care of that. You want Chime to take care of that administrative inefficiency.
Correct. And now the company might still get involved in administering exceptions, but not every single one,
got
right?
It, yeah.
What the smart contract does is it allows you to scale international business. The key is international business. And that's a new efficiency into the market, and that's a great part.
And in the business model, what does that scale mean to you for operationalizing it? More people, you have to hire them?
More cash. No, less people and more cash, because there's more automation, right? I mean, it's more software development.
Where's the cash coming from?
So we have a lot of revenue products. Like the obvious, like every other website, we have subscription revenue and advertising revenue. Subscription revenue comes from IMDb is the LinkedIn of the music TV and film business, right? Yeah. So we'll have that too.
Yeah.
But in addition,
it's not really large, though.
Yeah,
it can be.
It's okay. Amazon could make it larger if they wanted to. They have the reasons for doing it the way they do it. But in our case, I'll give you an example of some revenue products. Okay, let's say you want to crowdfund a project. So let's say you want a bunch of Taylor Swift fans to crowdfund a project for her to do a duet with Kanye West. Right? Sounds preposterous. But it's goofy enough.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd be amazed at what's... Stormy Daniels is crowdfunding a project for her legal bills with Donald Trump, and I bet you it's going to get funded, right?
I would agree.
So there's a lot of nutty stuff that gets crowdfunded, right?
The wisdom of the crowd is actually efficient.
Yes, that's right. And the whims of the crowd. But also, I'll give you another example. Let's say if they go to a webpage about an artist, the band All American Rejects, for example, and Wheeler, one of the band members. It's 10 years ago, if you could have given your niece a gift of a CD of All American Rejects. Well, good luck now. They wouldn't even know what the CD is in many cases, right? But what you could do is say, hey, you know what? I'll give you a gift of a Google Hangouts chat with him, and I'll pay $200 for that or $500 for it. I mean, you wouldn't think
it's probably a bot, but anyway. But how do you make this happen? So this is really important. You're creating value by allowing people to collaborate in a way that's different, so that scales.
Right.
Is that going to be done on the Chime contract?
Yes. So,
or it's all going to be part of one currency.
One currency, that's right. And now we're very careful. We brought in as an advisor Rod Garrett, who gave one of the keynotes here yesterday. Rod Garrett is the money supply economist from
UCSB.
Yeah. But he was also former VP at the New York Fed. He was the leader at the New York Fed for cryptocurrency. Rod is one of the smartest people I've ever met.
You know him?
Very well now. And you know what? Rod can explain the most complex things in simple words, which means he actually understands them. So we've actually used Fisher's equation to help model the utility token value over time. And again, it's designed to appreciate, but we don't want like nutty appreciation because then it'll be useless as a currency, right?
Yeah.
We have fixed supply, the Bitcoin principle, the fixed supply, and you know, and stable market makers, so we can keep it reasonably stable.
You're using the utility token to create value on your network.
You have to
so
create value.
The creators can capture that value.
Correct.
That's what you're doing on the utility.
Yes.
Security is the money-making side. How are you backing the security token? With equity or cash flow?
Equity, and very important, okay? Really important. If you did a percentage of revenue royalties, it wouldn't work. And
why?
I'll tell you why. Well, it wouldn't scale. Because we're looking 5 years out, 10 years out for this to be a good investment. We want investors to buy it, right? And if you, let's say you need to do a secondary because an acquisition becomes available because you're low on money or whatever, right? Then how do you do a secondary? You know, if you've already given away 20% of your revenue to token holders, what do you have to do a secondary tertiary capital round? Now, how many rounds were necessary for Spotify, or I happen to know Spotify was six, right? Facebook, Google, how many rounds of financing did they do? Okay, a lot, and by the way, they still might do more.
So basically the revenue share is a hair on the deal. Really puts a lot of hair on the deal.
Destroys it, in my opinion, destroys it. I mean, it's a dressing thing, but look, if you're really gonna grow to a major company and be a 5-10 year success, it kills it. Look, this is my opinion. Other people.
What percentage of equity do you say they're gonna do a $50 million raise, hard cap, soft cap, say 25, that's what seems to be the norm right now. What would be a percentage of equity converting to tokens?
Well, okay,
you'd see?
In Chime's case, all right, so we have a common A, okay, class of stock. We're creating a preferred class of stock called a Series T, which represents about 40, which if fully sold will be about 43% of the equity in the company, okay? And we had to do a preferred stock because there's too many in Delaware corporate law, which, you know, all the tech companies are all Delaware, right? In Delaware corporate law, common stock would be very difficult to make a token. You can do whatever you want with preferred. So the preferred is more flexible, so it's actual equity, actual shares. It's not a derivative, it's not a rev share, it's not a royalty, it's actual equity.
It's paper that converts nicely and it scales on the business side.
And the benefit of that, so you say, what's the valuation? So we're selling $100 million worth of the equity, or we're offering $100 million of the equity. In that, the pre-sale valuation is a little over $200 million. In Chime's case, that's because though we're not a startup. We're a startup, early stage company, but we went
out. How old is the company?
Pardon me?
How old is the company?
3.5 years.
Okay, so you're around. We went out yesterday.
We acquired music databases that were built at a cost of tens of millions of dollars in Europe, okay?
Yeah.
Funded by the richest guy in Europe, okay, who built it out and then got tired of it. Tired of funding it, and then we were able to pick it up on attractive, basically for equity deals, paper deals. We picked it up, and we're buying a second music database also. It's a very big one. So it's not like we're a startup with an idea and a business plan.
No, you got assets.
Yeah, real assets.
You got momentum, good management team. You obviously know what you're doing. It's awesome. Got a great scalability mindset.
Yes, that's
right. Nicely packaged, clear target.
That's right. So, I mean, we're probably a little bit different than a lot of crypto startups and that. I mean, a lot of brilliant entrepreneurs to see here, but we've been around the block with having to do IPOs, having to do exits, having to do, and you know, look, I'm a contrarian, right? You know, I was getting a lot of advice yesterday from a lot of really smart people saying, hey, raise the money overseas through a foundation and do this, and I'm like,
everyone's doing it.
It's like, look, I'm gonna take a contrarian approach. I'm just gonna comply with the law by doing a registration, and they say, well, what if your utility token has to comply with money transmitter laws? Look, then we'll comply with them, okay? It's like, look, the contrarian approach is just whatever the law is, follow it. And it gives us the
The thing is, you're actually doing what they want you to do, notifying what you're doing.
Yeah.
And you have a utility.
Yeah, that's right.
It's actually a utility.
So by separating out the token into two, one that has the attributes of a currency, one that has the attributes of an equity, neither one is screwing up the other.
I agree. That's really smart and very novel. You know, a lot of smart people are going down that road because it's actually known things people can understand.
Yes.
Security token is paperwork that you can do.
Yes, but I'll tell you, the other thing I feel is very important, probably an important point I make. By doing registration, the resale can go to anybody. My personal opinion is, you know, these second market type approaches that you can only resell them to accredited investors or to foreign investors or whatever. I think that's a mistake, and I'll tell you, I think what happens is people who take that approach are going to find that the resale value of the token or the tokenized securities is going to be about 10% of what it would have been otherwise.
If they only do accredited?
Well, yeah, because here's the thing, okay? First, it's not only they got to be accredited.
How do you get around the security token?
Because it's registered. You can, the waitress, working the bar here, can buy a publicly traded equity if it's registered, right? Okay, so she could buy a publicly traded
token. That's a Form 10 you were talking about.
Right. Form 10 registers the company. Now, the initial batch of trading will be done under 144 because the token holders will all hold them 6 months, so they can sell them at their leisure, right? Now, there are exceptions, by the way, like an affiliate might have to do some form filing. I would have to file a Form 3, you know, the usual stuff, right?
Yeah.
But a regular token investor, you can do whatever he wants. And I can call them investors. I can do business in the United States. I don't have to pretend I'm domiciled in a country I never heard of, right? So it's like, look, I'm an American. My staff is mostly American. We do business in America. Let's follow American law instead of...
Joe, this is a great conversation. We're getting down and dirty under the hood. Capital structure, business models, Chimes. Really interesting approach. Joe, thanks for sharing that great data here on theCUBE. Section 12G of the 1935 Securities Act.
34
Act. Form 10 is the secret weapon that was built by aliens before us to allow us to get this special clause in there for crypto. I'd love to continue this conversation another time. I think there's four or five things we just identified. Great topics. Thanks for sharing. It's theCUBE's coverage here in Puerto Rico. I'm John Furrier. We'll be back with more after this short break.